Hello, in this lecture we are going to discuss concurrency in Android. And basically, an Android application, or when a system starts an Android application, it actually starts a new Linux process for that application. And inside that Linux process, there exists a single thread that executes your application. And by default, actually, all the components, all the same components for the application, this is the default setting. That all the default components, they run in the same process and thread, which is the main, we refer to that thread as the main thread, or we refer to it as the UI thread. So these components will run, or they will share the same thread. Okay, now we can change the behavior of the system. However, this is the default. Now this obviously can be customized, and we can create additional threads, or even we can also dictate that whenever a specific component starts, it starts another process. But we are talking about the default behavior. Now, that main thread performs a lot of work. For example, this main thread, actually one of its tasks is to go and check the event queue. So whenever the user clicks on the screen or clicks on a component in your application, there is an event that gets packaged, and that event that gets packaged by the system is inserted into an event queue that belongs to the application. And the main thread has to go and check the event queue. So then when it goes and checks the event queue, it finds out that there is an event. Say, for example, this is clicking on a button, and it routes that event to the corresponding event handler so that that event can be handled. Okay. It also the main thread also handles a lot of other things. For example, it also handles the UI. For example, if you would like to create the onCreate method, for example, of activities, it runs in the main thread. You know, this is where you do the inflation of the layout, and you generate the layout and so on. Now, the main thread, for that reason, is also referred to as the UI thread. Okay. Now, the UI components in Android are not thread safe, or they are not built to handle concurrency, meaning they cannot be accessed by more than one thread at any given time. The rule of thumb is that the main thread or the UI thread, which is the same thing, are supposed to be the only threads that access the UI. Okay? Now, what happens is that, what if the you receive, say, for example, an onClick, a click event. That click event actually is a packaged event that gets inserted into the event queue of the application, and then the main thread goes and checks to see, hey, do I have events? Do I have events? So it checks the queue to see if the queue has any events, and if it finds an onClick or finds some kind of an event, it takes that event and maps it to the corresponding event handler. Okay. So now it is very important that this UI thread checks this event handler. Checks this event queue. Now, if the main thread or the UI thread get very busy doing something else, this means that nobody is checking the UI event queue. In that case, this means that the user is clicking on things on the screen or interacting with the UI, and nobody is there to handle these events. So the user thinks that the application is crashing, right? So you should never make that main thread busy, or occupy the main thread with very long tasks. So this just goes over the process of queuing an event into the event queue, and then the main thread is actually the queue that requests and actually manages it. So the idea is that the application is a single thread application, and heavy processing can easily yield poor performance, because what's going to happen is that if you make the UI thread access the network, for example, or you make the UI thread do very intense arithmetic or intense operations, in that case it will take time, and this time means that there is nobody checking the event queue. This means that nobody is actually handling the input of the user. So when the UI is blocked, no events can be dispatched, and the UI freezes, and the user actually perspective of the application, that the application is has hanged. Okay. Now, Android has ANR, which is application not responding. So if your application, or if the UI thread is blocked for more than a few seconds, which is around 5 seconds, you will get an ANR dialog. And actually, the ANR dialog looks something like that. It will tell you that, hey, your application is not responding. What do you want to do? Do you want to close it or you want to continue? So another thing to pay attention to is that the Android UI toolkit is not thread safe. So this means that it does not manage any concurrent accesses on the UI. So in that case, that there is an inherent assumption that the UI should only be accessed by the main thread. Okay? So there are two very, very simple rules. One, do not block the main thread or the UI thread. Don't block them. Okay? That thread should always do very light tasks. Okay? Should not perform heavy tasks. The second thing is that do not access the Android UI toolkit, yani meaning do not access the buttons, do not set messages, do not change the user interface in any thread other than the main thread. So the main thread has two properties. One, it should not be blocked. Two, it is the only thread that should be able to access the UI. So some of you will ask me, yes, I have tried from a child thread to access the UI. Yes, it will work, but this is not the correct design. Or the correct design approach. Why? Because at the end of the day, we agreed. The agreement is that, or other developers also assume that the main thread is the only thread that should access the UI. And if you don't oblige by this assumption, you can get a lot of issues where you can get race conditions and you can get threads fighting for access of specific resources, which they assume that they have access to. So two rules, very simple. Do not block the main thread and only access the interface from the main thread. Okay, actually this simplifies things a lot. Okay, now how can the main thread, so if the main thread is not going to do these heavy weight lifting tasks, so the main thread has to have a mechanism to create workers or other threads which it can delegate tasks to. Okay, so in that case, we call them workers. So we'll create worker threads. And creating worker threads can perform these heavyweight tasks, and they can operate in the background. Now, to create Java worker thread is very, very simple. You should perform these simple steps. One, you create a class that implements the runnable interface. So there's a runnable interface that you'll have to implement. You create a class that implements the runnable interface. And you take that implementation of the class, so you create a class that implements the runnable interface, and then you run it. How do you run it? There are actually two approaches to run a runnable, something that implements a runnable. One, either you pass it on to a thread and tell it start, or you pass it on to a thread pool. And both of them have their own properties. So you pass it on to a thread. This means you create an execution medium for it, and you pass on the runnable, and it will execute. Or you can create a thread pool, which is a group of threads that are going to do tasks for you. And then you pass it on to the thread pool. And if there is a thread that is available, the task will be performed. If not, your task will wait until one of the threads in the pool is available, and so on. Okay? So now, what is this runnable interface? It's very, very simple. This runnable interface has only one method inside it, which is called run. And the run method should include all the workload that should be executed in the background by this child thread or the worker thread. It looks something like that. I'll have, say, for example, do work. So you create a class, do work, implements runnable. And inside it, there is a run method. This run method will run in another context. It will run in the context of the child thread or the worker thread. Okay, so this is basically a mechanism of describing work. So the run method is where your heavy weight lifting or lengthy processing will be performed. This is, for example, inside this method, you will be accessing, say, the network, or you will be accessing heavy file system accesses, or you're doing this heavy processing that you would like to perform. Okay, now how do we run threads? So there are two approaches of running threads. One, you create a thread instance and pass it an instance of the class that actually implements the runnable. So now you know that you need to execute this runnable. You just pass it on to the task, to a thread instance that you created, and then you just execute or you run that thread or start the thread. Now, there is a small issue is that if you require multiple threads to complete several tasks, this approach does not enable you to control the number of threads created. So, for example, say you want to access 10 links on the internet, okay, 10 connections. You want to create 10 connections and retrieve, or you want to retrieve 10 pictures off the internet. So, if you create a thread for each one of them, this requires a lot of resources. Okay, so the other approach is to create a thread pool. So you can create a thread pool of size, say, 3, so it has 3 threads in it, and then you pass it on as many tasks as you want, but these tasks will only be performed by these 3 threads that are inside the pool. If all the threads are busy, then your task will wait until one of the threads comes back and it is not occupied, and it will execute the new task. So this approach actually allows you to set the maximum number of threads to be created. So in mobile application development, if you need multiple threads to do stuff, it is heavily advised to use a thread pool. Okay, and I'll show you how to do that. So for example, this is a class that we are looking at here. It's just called DoWork, and it implements runnable, and this is the run method, and you could see it's here, it's doing some kind of background work, which is I'm looping, I have these two nested for loops just to do some heavy work. Okay, and then this is how you could use simple threads. Basically, all you will do is you'll create thread equals new thread, and you pass it on an instance of the class. In that case, this is just you are setting up the thread to do some work, and then you say thread.start, that would start the thread. Very straightforward. Okay, so here you create a single thread with a target, with target an instance of do work, and then basically you tell it to start, it will go and start to do this work. Okay, starting means that go ahead, create a thread and run the run method. Very nice. So now the thread pool is very, very similar, but it will do the following. One, you create using the executor service. You get, say, for example, a new fixed thread pool. So we are creating a thread pool of size 5. It has thread 5. It can have 5 threads maximum. And then all what you will do is you'll say task pool, or the thread, the pool, you'll say pool.execute, and then you pass it on an instance of work that you would like to do, or the instance of the runnable that you would like to perform. And then basically here it will go and add that task to the thread pool and execute it when a thread is available. Now, this is very important to pay attention to. So that you will use thread pools. It enables you, for example, to execute code in a separate thread, but this might cause resource congestion due to large number of threads. So in that case, you should use thread pools. Solution to avoid resource is to use a mechanism to manage these threads for you, and the thread pool is a set of threads that are managed by the environment and enables you to set a limit on the number of threads. And as we just saw, we'll use the thread pool executor, and it enables you to create a thread pool and schedule tasks into that thread pool. Now, implementing runnable, actually, there are so many ways of implementing runnable. It's like, for example, would I implement it inside my activity or outside the activity? Do I implement it as a separate file? Does the activity implement it? How do I implement runnable, and how do you implement it, and where you implement runnable interface will dictate and limit how the data is passed to and from the worker threads to the main thread, and so on. So now, how you will implement the runnable will dictate how you can pass data to the runnable, what data is accessible to the runnable, and so on, right? And how can runnable report back its results? Now, actually, the implementation options include the following. You can implement it as an anonymous class, or you can implement it as a separate the class that will implement runnable. You can implement it as a separate class that implements runnable, or you have the activity actually itself implement the interface, or you use an inner class inside the activity that actually implements the interface. So now let's look at each one of them. So this is an example of creating it as an anonymous class. You see here we created the thread pool, and then when we want to execute, we'll say new runnable. Obviously, this is reduces the amount of code you have to write, right? You don't have to create a lot of files. And it is very localized, where when the developer looks here, he say, yeah, he'd like to reschedule this kind of runnable. Okay, and you could see exactly what is the runnable doing. The problem here is that, as you could see, there is no constructor. You cannot create a constructor here. This means you cannot pass information to the runnable. And that causes a problem, right? So what if you wanted to pass it on some data to work on? So, and you could see this is very simple. And because this runnable is created in the context of the activity, it has access to the activity methods and attributes. While the disadvantage is that very limited functionality, it's not scalable. You cannot repeat, reuse it, because every time you have to reuse it, you have to cut and paste the anonymous class that you typed here. And it is not reusable. Plus, you cannot pass custom parameters. You cannot have a constructor here, and so on. So that is the anonymous class. Now, What if you would like to implement it as a separate class? What if you would like to implement the runnable as a separate class? So you have one file, which is the activity, and then the other file is your runnable, the class that implements runnable. The thing here is that, see, I can have a constructor, doWork. For the doWork class, I have a constructor. Say, for example, I pass it an integer value, say my max value, and then I will loop inside the run over that integer value. So I can control, I pass it custom data, right? I have it as a separate class, has a constructor, I can pass it custom data. Very nice. So now the idea here is that, what are the advantages of this? Obviously here that you can easily reuse. Two, you can customize the execution of the runnable by passing it different information or by using that constructor. But it has one of the main issues is that because this is a separate file, or it's a separate class and a separate file, you could see that it has no access to the activity, meaning it has no access to all the methods inside the activity and the attributes that are inside the activity. So one that you can easily reuse and can easily set up by passing parameters through the constructor. You can see here I can pass parameters through the constructor. The disadvantage is that it's difficult to access the main activity. See, the main activity does not have it as an inner class, thus it cannot access it that easily. Now you can the activity itself can implement runnable, and you could see here that you could say activity implements runnable, and here is the run method. Obviously the biggest advantage here, and you could see here I could say task pool.execute this, because this is refers to the activity which actually implements the interface with the runnable interface, and the runnable here is the run method. Now this makes it too customized for the main activity, and whoever wants to use this, if you want to reuse it, you have to actually create an instance of the main activity, which is it doesn't make sense to do. But this is so customized for the activity, and it has access to all the resources in the activity. At the same time here, that you now there is no constructor that you can have to customize. It's not easily customizable. So the advantages are it's simple implementation, can access the activity methods and attributes. However, very limited functionality, not scalable. You cannot reuse this because it doesn't make sense to create an instance of the main activity only to run the run method. Now, also it can cause problems with synchronization because this run method can access resources that are managed by the main activity. And you know, the main activity actually is managed by the main thread or the UI thread, right? Also, it's hard to pass parameters because you don't have a constructor here that you create. You can also implement it as an inner class, meaning that the main activity does not implement the interface. Instead, you create the class inside the main activity. This has its advantages, of course. Now the code is localized, it's simple. Plus, you can have a constructor for the do work so that you can control, for example, see I have two tasks here that are scheduled. One of them I pass 100,000, the other one is 200. The max value is different in both of them, and you can create custom kind of async tasks, or sorry, custom kinds of runnables. Now, the disadvantage is that, again, it is localized into the main activity and cannot be used outside it, right? So the advantage is simple implementation, can access the main activity attributes. Now, it's very tightly related to the main activity. It can cause problems with synchronization because now there might be some attributes that are shared between the main activity and the activity itself, or the outer class and the inner class. But see, we looked at different ways of implementing things based on your design or on the application that you are building. You have to decide which version or which type you would like to use. Now, I showed you how to create a child thread. That child thread will go and do something right now. The problem is that child thread, as we mentioned earlier in the lecture, cannot or should not access the UI. Okay, so because it cannot access the user interface, this means that, say, for example, it wants to show an alert message, or it wants to alert the user about the progress of a download of a file or something. It cannot, the child thread or the worker thread cannot do that by itself, or should not do that by itself. Instead, it should notify the main thread about the progress, and the main thread will perform the UI manipulation. And also at the same time, the child thread will go do some task, and it will, when the task is done, it comes back with some kind of result. Either say, for example, it has downloaded a file, or it has downloaded a website or something. So this result has to be passed back to the main thread. And this means that we need communication between these threads. Now, the problem is that to enable such a communication with one another, has been handled a lot in computer science, or even in the Java, yani in the Java community, when you look at Java synchronization. So there is a Java synchronization mechanisms where you can synchronize the access to specific resources so that you can enable the communication between threads. You can do that also in Android. However, life is much simpler. What we will look at is that we have assumed that the UI, we are not going to synchronize it. The UI only accessed by the main thread. So no need for synchronizing the UI. That's one. Now, we have to find a mechanism for child threads to send, or for the worker threads to send information back to the main thread. Also, vice versa. What if the main thread wants to talk back to the child threads? Okay. So now, the simple approach is to use the Android's message passing capabilities, which is actually a thread safe mechanism. So now there are two main possible capabilities that we will discuss in the next lecture. These two possible approaches to manage communication between the child thread and the main thread are, one of them is using a handler class, and the other one is using an async task class. We will look at both options, and we will look at what both of them provide in the next lecture. Thank you.